In that seat, and I want to mess that up just a little bit Because if you're able to stand, I want to ask you to stand. And we're going to sing together, "There Shall Be Showers of Blessing." Let's stand and let's sing it together. Singing, I'll ask you to be seated as our pastor comes.
Amen. Good singing this morning. Good to see you. Showers of blessing. We were in Foley, Alabama this last week, and when the big storm came through, we were in a nice place, but we didn't have our umbrellas when we got ready to leave. I have not been that wet except in a shower. It was raining so hard, my shoes were full of water, everything just wet. I tried to get her to the car without getting her wet. I was not very successful. So you can't have showers of blessing that are more than can be a blessing, just getting you wet. But we enjoyed our trip there. We appreciate Brother Eddie being here and sharing the word with you last week. He's a good man, loves the Lord. And I know he's faithful in his work constantly. If you're visiting with us this morning, we welcome you to the service. We hope you'll feel right at home as we share together. And if you're watching us online, we appreciate that. We hope you are able to get everything clearly and really enjoy the service with us. If you know some of the songs, sing along. If you don't, just whistle. We'll get with you later. We have a message this morning for some of you that are at home. So I hope you'll not change and go elsewhere, but you need to hear what I have to say today. Many of you do, and I hope you'll stay with us all the way through that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the day, for your blessings. We do thank you for the rains that we've had through this much of spring. Father, we pray you'll just continue to bless us, and not just with rain, but in the other areas that you do, particularly with your grace and your mercy and your love. Father, and that we might bless others with these same things in our life. Father, that we might really show that we love the other people, not just in our church, but in our town, in the other places that we travel. Father, we commit this service unto you, in Jesus' name, amen.
This morning, the choir, with Greg Stroud as soloist, will be singing a selection that I think has become a favorite of many of us. It's a favorite of mine. It asks what sounds like just a simple question, but if we answer it in the affirmative, it can change our lives. It can change our lives. And the question is simply this: is he worthy? Is he worthy? It starts with the words, do you feel the world is broken? I do. Don't you? Something's wrong out there. He is worthy of our praise and our worship. Listen prayerfully as we sing.
Shadows deepen. But do you know that all the dark won't stop life from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Does the Father truly love us? Does the Spirit move among us? And is Jesus our Messiah who forever goes to cross? Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Oh,
Not a powerful song. Oh, Lord God, help us today to recognize your worthiness of our praise. I'm going to ask you to sing with us our offertory hymn, Let's don't do that one. Let's do Heaven Came Down and Glory Filled My Soul. If you need the hymnal, it's 438. But the words will be on the screen. Let's sing it together. Sing it with energy.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget. After I've wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met.
Heaven came.
Thank you allowing us to be in your house today, dear Lord. Dear Lord, we ask for your blessing and your mercy, dear Lord, and be with this world today, dear Lord. You know all that's going on. Pray that their heads prevail, dear Lord. And dear Lord, we just pray that you be with Brother Rodney as he brings your word today. And just pray that speak to our hearts, dear Lord. And dear Lord, we just pray as we tithes and offerings today, dear Lord, we just pray that they be used, that you would have them to be used to further your kingdom. These things we pray in thy name. Amen.
Thank you, Terry and Steve. There were a lot of people that would love to have had some time alone with Jesus when he was teaching. I'm sure there were people that asked the disciples if they could be with him by themselves. I'm sure there were options for some folks that others didn't have. Maybe depending on where they were standing or where they were sitting or whatever they were doing. But a lot of people would love to have had a moment with Jesus by himself. Just had some time to talk to him, to ask questions. Occasionally, if that might be the case for someone you know or someone that's in a bigger position, as a mayor or as a governor or as president or whatever, the people that want time with him, people can usually find a way to get to at least have a few words. And in our passage this morning, Nicodemus is the one that has that opportunity. He didn't try to talk to him during the day. He didn't try to talk to him during the afternoon. He didn't interrupt any messages or teachings that he was doing. He just waited until nighttime came. And as night came, Nicodemus goes to Jesus. If you have your Bibles or the scripture on the screen, it says in John chapter 3 in the first verse, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi or teacher, we know that you are a teacher come from God. For no one else can do these signs. As he mentions no one else can do the signs, he's talking about the miracles that Jesus has been performing. And not, as far as scripture goes, not necessarily they're all written down. Somebody asked me one time, they said, how many signs or miracles did Jesus perform? I said, well, I have no idea. They said, well, how many in John does it say that he performed? I said, John didn't write how many he performed. He said, well, how about all those in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and combined with John? How many did he perform? I said, none of those can tell you how many performed. And they said, well, that just seems funny that he didn't tell you. And I said, well, have you ever read the last part of John? And the person said, no. If you turn to John, and it's not going to be on the screen, if you turn to John chapter 20 and drop down to verse 30 and 31, it says this, and truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may know and believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. If you go to the very last chapter in the book, chapter 21, and drop down to verse 25, it says this, and there are also many other things that Jesus did, some of those signs and miracles, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. So if anybody ever asks you how many miracles or signs Jesus did, you can say with me, I have no idea. I have no idea. They're not all written anywhere. We just have a little bit, just a few, just so we have an understanding of who Jesus is and what Jesus could do. The many things he could do. But he didn't do all of them. He just did enough for the people of the day to realize he was not just a rabbi. He was so much more than that. He was not just a teacher. He was not one who claimed to be something that he wasn't. That he could do whatever God wanted him to do. In the way of miracles or teaching or anything else. So if you can grab that, Jesus answered him when he asked that question, no one can do these signs, or he made that statement, no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Now, there's not a bigger truth than that. God has to be with you for you to be able to do anything worthy. And Jesus did exactly as God called him and told him to do with every miracle that he did. So that's important to remember as well. Jesus answered and said to him when he made that statement, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Now, did Nicodemus ask that question? Has he asked that question yet? No. But it's coming. And Jesus goes straight to it. He just cuts the line. There's no sense talking about all the signs. There's no sense talking about all the miracles. There's no sense talking about all these other things. "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Does Nicodemus get it? Absolutely not. He doesn't. As smart a man as he was, as good a leader in some cases as he was, Nicodemus said to Jesus, "How can a man be born when he is old? How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Of course not. Kind of a crazy question to ask. But it's the only thing he can come up with. To say, are you talking about being born of your mother again? Do I have to do that? Does it take two times to do that? And Jesus said to him, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." Now, being born of water has been misconstrued by two or three denominations, saying that means you got to be baptized and so forth, and that's not the case. When he talks about being born twice, and he says being born of water, how did all of us get here? Were we born of water? Absolutely. Absolutely. We were born of water. It's called a water birth. What do you hear often said? "Oops, my water broke." Okay, you got it. That's the birth he's talking about. The birth that you had. Jesus goes on to say, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." You say, "Are you sure about the water part?" Yes, I am, because here's what Jesus said. "That which is born of the flesh," that's your water birth from your mom, "that which is born of the flesh and that which is born of the Spirit is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again." He said, you got to be born. Not, you're born of your mother, you've had your water birth, now you got to have a spiritual birth. And when we invite Jesus Christ into our life, that's what we have, right? We have a spiritual birth. Oh, I just need to know one time at least that you're with me, right? All right. You know, you help me and I'll help you. He says you must be born again. Folks, there is nothing that can take the place of the spiritual birth of being born again. Many people, when they're talked to about following Christ, being a Christian, they'll start talking about how faithful they've been in church. It doesn't matter how faithful you've been in church to be saved. You got to be born again. It doesn't matter how much money you get. You got to be born again. It doesn't matter all the good things that you do in life. And there are a lot of people that do many, many good things in life, but they do not know Jesus Christ as a personal Savior because they have never been born again. And you got to be born again. You've all had your first birth, but you've got to have that second one to be born again. That's your spiritual birth. And that's the most meaningful of the two, is your spiritual birth. So that's vitally important. When I gave a welcome to those that are at home or otherwhere this morning, I made a comment. I'd want them to stay with us through the message. And that's because it's just in my heart, I'm believing that some of you that are at home, you've done a lot of good things in your life, and you enjoy turning on the programs, Christian programs, church services at home, but have you been born again? Because that's all that matters. That's all that matters. Nothing else matters except you be born again by the Spirit of God. Jesus said, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, physical birth, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit, your spiritual birth. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. Just notice how he is just sticking with that topic as he talks to Nicodemus. Nicodemus is such a Pharisee. Oh, listen, he's done everything you can do that he thinks is right. He's projected himself as so close to God and so spiritual in his life. And yet, he does not know what it means to be born again. He's never had a spiritual rebirth. So he's no better than anyone out in the streets, anyone in a bar, anyone anywhere else. He's no better off than they might be. He does not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, I'll give something good for him. I'll say something good for him. He was hungry enough for what he had been hearing Jesus say that he wanted to come to Jesus and find out exactly what he was missing in his life, what he needed in his life. Because, you know, until you admit that you need more than what you can do, you can't be saved. Until you can admit that you're a sinner, you can't be saved of your sins. You've got to admit those things. And he was coming to that place in his life. Jesus said, the wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, you can hear it, but cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. And so is everyone who is born of the Spirit. It's not that you have to see it. It's not that you have to know exactly where it comes from. If you ask Jesus to come into your life, to be born of the Spirit of God, it's not what you see that matters. It's who you become. It's who you become in Jesus Christ. And that's what's so important about Nicodemus being there before Jesus. Nicodemus answers and says to him, but how can these things be? He's still listening. He's still trying to get there. How can these things be? And Jesus answered and said to him, are you a teacher of Israel and do not know these things? You stand as a teacher that you know so much, and yet right now by re-questioning and wondering what's going on spiritually and all, are you really the teacher that you claim to be? Do you not understand? Notice what Jesus said then. And he says it like it's the plural of he and God, and maybe he and God in the Spirit even talking. He says, we speak what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not receive our witness. If I had told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? How will you believe if you're not going to believe what I tell you about the earthly things? How are you going to accept and believe the spiritual things, the things that are of heaven? No one has ascended to heaven but he who came down from heaven. Who's he talking about? Himself. Himself.
He said, you're not going to understand. You're not going to know. As Moses lifted up the spirit in the wilderness, he goes back to Old Testament times, to where those that would look upon it could be saved, could be not have to die there. He said, the Son of Man also has to be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but would have eternal life. Wow. I think he's laid it out there, don't you? You got to know Jesus. You got to know Jesus. Not just the name, not just know him in your mind, not just know him with words. You've got to know him from your heart, from your very own spirit, to be able to come into a relationship with him. And Jesus changes your life drastically. I don't mind using that word at all. Drastically, he changes your life. And he wants to change everyone's life that's here this morning exactly that way if it's never happened to you before. Because some still rely so much upon coming to church or joining a church or being baptized as salvation, and they're not. It takes having a relationship with Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us very simply, it's a verse, all of you that have been saved for very long, a verse that you know, probably know it by heart, probably share it with other people. For God so loved the world. Now grab that. You've got to get a hold of that. Because we don't look at it right most of the time. God so loved the world. That's everybody in the world. That's everybody that's been born. And you say, well, he can't love people that have done certain things. He loved you and the things you've done. We've all committed sin. We've all done wrong. We've all made mistakes. We've all made bad decisions. And that does not keep God from loving you. And for all of those in other countries and other places that are even doing wrong this morning, God still loves them. God still loves them. And you say, but how can he do that? How can he do that? Because he's God. He's God of love. So much love that he died for the whole world. Now, when it comes time that the world ends, then there will be a separation between those who know the Lord and those who do not know the Lord. But God loves those who do not know him. And the strange thing is, I call it strange, it's really not strange. Let's just say the thing is, God expects us to love other people like he loves them. He expects us to love other people like he loves them. And don't tell me in your mind you don't have some lines drawn that say, I can love these, I can't love these. Well, it's funny in a way, then how much do you really love God? Because God says several times in the New Testament, I want you to love other people like I love you. I want you to love the others like I love you. And he's talking about all the people in the world. Do you have a hard time with that sometimes? I mean, go ahead, shake your head yes. Come on. No, don't lie, God's looking. We have trouble with that sometimes, don't we? We have trouble with that. But it's our trouble. Because at that moment, we've cut ourselves off from thinking like God thinks and loving like God loves. To going back to the old way of thinking
that we'll choose who we love and who we don't love. When God said, love the world like I love the world, he didn't say pick and choose. He said, love the world like I love the world. Love other people like I love the people. And that breaks all barriers down. How well do we do that? Not well. Not well. But the only way we reach most people is by the way we love. The only way we generally bring people to Jesus is by the way we show Christian love to them. How well do we do that? How well do we do that? Good question. He gave his only begotten Son that whoever believes in him. Did you get it? That whoever believes in him. It doesn't matter their color, it doesn't matter their gender, it doesn't matter their habits, it doesn't matter. God loves them anyway. And God wants us to love them too. Yes, it's hard. Yes, it's hard. But most of the time, that defines who's really saved and who's not. Are you willing to share Jesus with other people? And just any other people? I can't say I'm perfect in that, but I've learned a whole lot about that. I've been put in positions where I ended up in the hospital rooms with people with AIDS, with people with nearly any disease they could catch from anything that was bad. Alcoholics dying that had been shared with over and over again. One that I went to see, he never stopped. He never quit. He never accepted the Lord. But on his last day of life, he asked me to come to Methodist Hospital in Houston and see him. And at that moment, his stomach and all was so swollen, he looked like he was 10 or 12 months pregnant. That's hard to be. And he was as yellow as he could be. And yet never saved, still called me pastor. He said, you're the only pastor that's ever been to see me, that's ever talked to me. But he still died without Jesus. Because this pastor can't save anybody, and neither can you. We can give the good word, we can share, we can pray, we can love, and we're supposed to be doing all those things. But when you look at yourself in the mirror, just remember, you can't save anyone. Only Jesus saves. You get them as close as you can. That's all I can say. Get them as close as you can, but they've still got to be the one to make the decision. They've still got to be the one to ask Jesus to come into their life. And I'll admit, it leaves you broken when you don't.
when somebody passes basically right in front of you and you know they died without Jesus. That hurts. But once again, it reminds you, you can't save them. You can take them to the door, but you can't make them open it. I wonder this morning, how many people do you think are watching that do not know Jesus? How many people possibly are in here that really do not know Jesus? They've never made a commitment. They never really asked Him to come into their life to forgive their sins. I honestly thought I would die before I was 18. I thought that for all of my early teen years. Was baptized at First Baptist Church Hutchins. Was leaning on that for my salvation. I mean, I'd been baptized. I'm bound to go to heaven. But that's not what the Bible says. Not when I was in my early 20s did I come to a realization that I did not have a relationship with Jesus. Oh, I knew all about Him. I could beat a lot of people in sword drills. I'd always been in church every Sunday. But I still didn't know Jesus in a personal way. That's why in a church crowd this size, if we could say, well, everybody that here knows Jesus or they wouldn't be here. That is not always true. There could be two or three or more sitting in here this morning that's never really asked Jesus to forgive their sins and come into their life. And this sermon is for you. And this invitation is for you. And you that are watching that do not know Jesus, this service is for you. My heart was burdened all week about this sermon and this service. The question's got to be asked, what are you going to do with Jesus? What are you going to do with Jesus? Will you ever get another opportunity? Will you ever get that one more invitation to come to know Jesus? Will you stand with me this morning? Let's pray together. Father, as we pray this morning, we pray for every person here and every person that might be watching that does not know Jesus Christ. Father, I pray for those at home that they'll sense by your Spirit touching their heart that they need the relationship that they don't have. And Father, right where they are this morning, they'll get on their knees and ask Jesus to forgive their sins and come into their life. And Father, I pray for anyone here. I don't care their age. I don't care how often they've gone to church. I don't care in some cases how long they've been a church member. That means nothing. Nothing. If they haven't invited Jesus into their life. Father, I pray at this time anyone here will be willing to make the decision that lasts for all eternity. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's sing a hymn of invitation. And I'm going to ask you to do what God is asking you to do. And I believe right now the Holy Spirit of God is asking several people to do things. And it's time to do them. It's time to do it. Let's sing together.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
Daddy, have you made that?
Oh, none go with behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning.
Stop at 2, we're going with 3 this morning. Let's sing one more verse.
The cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turn.
One request of you before we do our closing song. Be praying for those that were watching this morning and for those that are here this morning, that anyone that said no to Jesus today, the Holy Spirit will continue to work until they do. Can you do that? Continue to pray that the Holy Spirit will work in their life until they come to know Him personally. Amen. You have a great week. Let's close with our song.
Let's close the way we started, with this wonderful day by day. It's a prayer. Let's sing it. Day by day. Day by day. To see Thee more clearly, love Thee more dearly, follow Thee more nearly, day by day. God bless you. Hope you have a wonderful, wonderful week. Day by day.